All right, welcome back to Kinguin Pro League Season 1's like almost the finale at this point. We're nearing the very end of the playoffs. We have the third place match. We're just done casting the match between Life Coach and Sho. Yeah. Sho lost 2-4, that is, versus Life Coach. So he's now reclassed versus Strife Crow for a third place match.
Yeah, I guess this is not something Sho wanted to be in. Like, you know, he's playing, he wanted to win the whole
series. Of course.
Like, he's looking forward to win a whole tournament. He kind of lacks the big major achievement yet, which is winning a major, of course. And
this is definitely one of them. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think it's kind of disappointed that not winning the semifinal, but at the same spot, he's already like top three. I mean top four of a huge major event. It is an achievement in itself. But most pro players are just thinking about it. I just want to win.
Yeah, I just want that one big win. Like, we were talking about this when he faced Hyped, you know, in the first match that he had today. It was Hyped versus Sho, both of which, in the playoffs, are the only players who didn't have any title at this point, mm-hmm. like any big, you know, major win. And it would have meant a lot to Sho to win the entire thing. But I guess it's still amazing that he got to top three in the league stacked with some of the top players. And oddly enough, he's a player that, like, I want to say he's recent, but mm-hmm. it sometimes feel like he's been around for a long time. He's been playing Hearthstone for longer than I can imagine. But his appearance, consistent appearance in the pro scene, if you go back like a year and a half ago, it just wasn't a name that we saw back then.
Yeah, that's true. So, and still, going against Strife Crow in the first place match is another occasion to, you know, kind of put your name out for the bigger crowd, because maybe not everyone recognizes Sho as a good player yet, and this might change with this tournament.
It's kind of interesting, because if you put him like in the top, if he wins the top three, it's going to be, let's say like Life Coach or Colento in the mm-hmm. first two spots, mm-hmm. and then you have Sho directly, and then Strife Crow. So he's between three
the
of the top,
names.
Yeah, the biggest yeah. names. So somehow that's got to mean something, definitely.
But it kind of, you know, makes me happy that this tournament will be won by Life Coach or Colento. Like, those are the,
right,
I would say, two of the four best players, in my opinion, in the world. And one of those players will win the whole event. So
it just goes to show that all the people who say, you know, Hearthstone has, it's not really about the way you play, it's about the cards you get or the RNG you have. It's true to an extent, but I think people maybe overplay it a bit. When you start looking at the broader picture, there's definitely a trend where all the best players end up with the best bots.
I also want to point out that if we will get more decks like Grim Patron, the skill cap will increase in all decks.
Oh my god, that deck is so complex.
Yeah,
and you know what's interesting is we're talking about the misplays that you feel Life Coach made a few times, mm-hmm. and some of the lines, the opportunities he didn't seize. But I realized when I play against Grim Patron, when I see a frothing, I almost don't even like. I have to handle it right away, and like the fear that I have, like if I don't deal with it,
you
it feels like it always kills me.
Yeah.
And if I don't kill it, if I do kill it, then sometimes I don't have removal for later. So it feels like whatever I do is always a mistake against Grim Patron. I think it's easy to get punished against that deck.
Yeah, so but it's also easy to get punished as you play this
as
deck.
You play it. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. All right. Well, that being said, we're going to be talking about the third place match. We have Strife Crow versus Sho, as we mentioned. They're going to keep the same lineup they had. Strife Crow had Hunter, Paladin, Warlock, Warrior.
Zoo, Warlock.
Yeah, it's a Zoo, and Sho's Warlock, Warrior is a Handlock and Grim Patron. And pretty much everyone but Hyped in the playoffs brought Grim Patron, Warrior as a result of how strong it is. But both players here are playing Hunter. So there's a Face Hunter from Sho. I wonder if, I forget what Strife Crow's Hunter was. I think it might have been mid-range, but I have no recollection of that.
I think his match was so short.
Yeah, so the matches were so short.
Even
and quick.
Like,
I don't remember exactly what exactly his Hunter deck was. I know his Paladin deck is a mid-range deck. Did he even get through it at all? I think he just got completely steamrolled 4-1.
It was 4-1, and
so we didn't get to see the Hunter, I believe.
He used the Warrior three times, I guess.
Yeah, there was three matches of the same class and one Warlock, I believe, or some such thing. And Sho's got a Mage, which we know is Mech.
Yeah,
so that's going to be an interesting matchup. I just have to say, if one of the two hunters is mid-range and the other is face,
then the face hunter is really favorite in the mirror match.
Yeah.
I mean, in the class mirror match, not in the deck mirror match, because they play way differently.
Yeah.
And the face hunter is most of the time favorite because he has just a bigger pressure from the turn one. If it will be like uncontested Lepernomt in one.
Yeah, that's just enough. That's enough.
That might be enough.
Yeah, usually the extra bit of like you can get 6 damage out of the Lepernomt, it's over at that point. So
one mana fireball, kinda okay.
Yeah. One mana fireball in a class that has a hero power that's gonna put you on a clock. I mean it's really hard to avoid. And as Hunter, you play zero healing. You have no mitigation outside of Houndmaster or Belchers and older versions of midrange.
The only phase, the only possibility of you soaking damage through cards is Misha, Belcher, and Houndmaster.
Yeah, and you could maybe say Explosive Trap if you play that in midrange.
Well,
somehow.
Most of the time there's Freezing Trap.
Right.
And then it's Unleashed Hounds.
Yeah, and then it doesn't matter at all.
It doesn't really matter at all. Yeah.
So first game is going to be Paladin versus Mage. So Trifecrow is going to stick to his Paladin first. He's going to go for it. And shows Mech Mage versus Pally. That's a matchup I haven't seen much of recent days. It used to be like the big thing for a while. Paladin came back in the metagame after the Druid
because
Hunter.
Because of the Mech Mage.
Yeah, because of it. So I think there's definitely a chance that Trifecrow's got a good deck for that.
Yeah. And we'll see if he uses the decks like Cockhammer or an example like Double Belcher with no Quartermasters. It really depends. Like the builds of the Paladins are so different nowadays.
Yeah.
And it might include Dragon Consort.
I've seen, like, he's been toying around with the idea of Paladin on stream. I've seen him play a bit of that, and he's been experimenting with a lot of different curves of Paladin decks. And, you know, the initial, the Cro-Magus, Ysera, plus Nefarian, like, that's out of the window. So he went for a very, very low-curve Paladin deck with Dragons.
With Volcanic Dragon, because it makes sense.
The Volcanic Drake, yeah, exactly. Volcanic Drake with Muster, and you had like it felt like a really solid deck. And he went, I think, with a 66% win rate.
That's quite nice.
It's quite nice, but it feels like when I watch him play other Paladin decks, he's doing much better. So although it's good, I feel like Strifecrow's, like his skill carries the deck.
Okay.
More so than the deck. Yeah. Like, if he plays another deck, he's going to do much better with it. So, I am thinking it's got to be more of a standard Pally, but maybe he'll surprise me.
Yeah. We'll have to see that.
Dragon Pally. If I see that in a tournament format, I'll be happy. I mean, I really want to see dragons, but none of it has worked so far. Besides Rogue,
that's
with
quite
Malagot.
Unfortunate.
Yeah.
What about Malagos Shaman with Ancient.
Ancestor Skull?
Ancestor Skull.
Yeah. I mean, it's a fun deck, right? Like, you have the Drakes. You have 2 Fire Elementals now if you play the Blackwing Corruptors. So it does give the deck a bit more consistency in that you usually have the Fire Elementals or even earlier than usual. Yeah. But it's hard to get done because you have no card draw. So that becomes your downfall.
That was the exact same problem for every single Shaman deck.
Yeah, every single Shaman deck has the same structure because you have to compensate for variance with a very specific type of deck. The RNG on Totem, the RNG on Lightning Storm, Crackle, you have to have a consistent deck list that always does the same thing.
True. So we'll be jumping into the game.
Yep.
There's an anti-Keelbolt in the Paladin.
Oh man, it feels like Sho's head is floating. Maybe you didn't see that, but
I didn't see that.
Oh, you missed it. Well, that's too bad. All right.
Wow, double mirror entity in the opening hand.
GG, ladies and gentlemen. First game goes to... Actually, last time we saw that, we won. You remember that? There was like one game. I was like, well, this game is over. Oh, wait, never mind.
But when you have Mad Scientist who has no value...
Yeah, it's horrible.
That's like...
It doesn't even kill something here. Like, it just died.
You ping the minibot, and that's it. And then you play Spider Tank next turn.
Really what awful. A bad start for a Mech Mage. What a horrible, horrible start. It's not about to get better either.
Striker might be thinking, oh, maybe he's playing Freeze Mage.
Yeah, because maybe he didn't watch him play earlier. Well.
I guess Spider Tank.
It's not really weak to anything yet.
Only weak to...
Muster, but not even...
Abusive Sergeant, if he plays one. But I think that will be not the case. It can only die to attack from Master for Battle.
Yeah, which makes his... Like, he trades the 2 minions on the board.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we'll see what he does, but...
He goes for the Snow Trucker. I'm not sure if I like that.
Actually, I do. I think it's not too bad. It's just that... Strifecrow's Muster for Battle will neutralize a bit of this. To battle! You know, somebody had a theory about the Silver Hand recruit.
Hmm? What was the theory?
They only have one arm.
Why?
And you can see on the art, there's only one arm. And when the quartermaster comes out, he gives them the second one.
But there's a second arm on the art.
Is there?
Yeah, there is.
Okay, well, that's not a good theory then.
Theory disproven.
I guess so.
It's a horrible theory. Whoever made that theory, I demand that you double check your facts. Oh, what a nice card here from Strifecrow.
That's quite a nice top deck.
Throw the Silver Champion. Yeah, that's a perfect answer to this. Mm-hmm. Now the Mage, again, is falling behind. He's got his late game Antonitis, but...
That doesn't change much, I would say.
At the moment, it's...
Paladin will build such a strong board.
Yeah, by the time he gets anything done...
About the interface in Hudson, when there's a bug, and the arrow that is like pointing at something is coming out from the... From
the side,
from
the side. It's like pointing, so there's something outside of the frame.
It looks like someone from the other game, other board, is like pointing at you. It's like, play this.
Yeah, you should play the, you know, Night Shark, where you're like,
it feels like you're playing in a store, like hobby store, and someone playing right beside you is like, no, dude, you play that.
And God knows you love those guys.
Yeah, for sure.
Like, you should have played this card. Although we're doing the same thing.
We are these guys.
we're those guys.
Yeah.
We're just the guy like, hey, dude, you should have played this card. It was so much better.
So that's a mirror entity, right, on the board?
Yeah, it is. So I think this is a good time to pop it with Iron Beakel.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah. You don't know the other mirror entity is...
What about a Knife Juggler? And you keep the owl?
What about...
Knife Juggler into... Into Hero Power, and then you might sacrifice one of the minions.
I think, you could even sacrifice both if you wanted. Yeah, you're right.
Damn. What about Peacekeeper? Nah, you mirror.
What's the point?
You go with the Hero Power. Better Cure.
Okay. Yeah, I get the tempo plays.
Yeah, but still, this is way better.
Yeah, obviously. He's gonna be so far ahead right now. Blast Mage is going to do some work here. Show top decking back to back Mechwarper and Blast Mage. Definitely going to help.
If he kills all the creatures. Well, that was close.
Well, yes and no. I mean.
So you trade and play Sylvanas?
I feel like I kind of want to play. I don't even know what I want to do. Actually, all the plays that I make are possibly weak to something, but Sylvanas is the best one.
Yeah, I guess so. Like, you trade for the Blessed Mage.
Yeah.
So the Mage has to sacrifice Frostbolt.
Like, what's the big problem here for Sho is that he's got no card draw. Well, speaking of the devil, is he's running out of cards. It doesn't matter what cards he gets at this point. Yep. Like, he just has none. And the Paladin has way too many options.
Now, Strifecrow might fall into a trap when he will use the Owl for that.
And then Archmage comes out.
Archmage comes down, and if there will be no answer to, like, a top-decked, let's say, Clockwork Gnome, Frostbolt, Fireball, he might be in a pickle.
Yeah, it would be a pickle.
Okay. Well, the Mini Watt is also okay to drop. Well, I guess you dropped the Antonitis, right? Do you?
I don't know.
What do you achieve with...
Shredder? I don't know.
Shredder against
the Belcher. Every play you make is going to get punished, I feel. But it's kind of like not playing Blast Mage when you don't have anything else to do.
It feels way worse because it doesn't trade for the stage 1 Belcher.
I guess he's going to go for the Shredder and try to get some
actually,
value
actually, stage
out of
2 Belcher.
Yeah.
Because it gets de-evolutioned after it dies.
I had the theory that it was a Golchar Footman inside the belly that got melted
it
down.
It should have been like that.
Yeah.
Like a special edition Belcher, like a promo one, you know?
With he spawned the Golchar Footman ready for action.
Follow the rule is and you die.
Yeah, that's a really, really strong board from Strifecrow. And Sho probably doesn't play any Flamestrike. I just don't see it. Archmage is dead on board. And, I mean, this is just...
Frostbolt? Nope.
You know, am I the only one in positions like these where I just leave the game? I don't know, maybe I'm the only one on ladder. When I end up in games like these, I'm fire bat mode and I just like out of four.
No save.
Yeah, not at all, nothing.
Consecration for 9, not a good draw, but you just drop Harrison Jones and that's it.
I think Consecration, the cost that it has, is not worth it, but you still get a clean board and the mage has probably no answer.
Why would you trade?
What's gonna punish you?
I guess you kill him faster if you just go all phase.
Yeah, but...
And then he can't kill the zombie chow.
For 5 health?
Yeah.
In case now he has flame strike. I mean, what's the worst that happens? Dr. Boom, right? That's like the absolute worst. Dr. Boom comes out with perfect boom bots.
Yeah.
Like, that's the only thing that could really punish you. When a mech mage plays archmage like this...
Oh, look at that!
That's convenient. Actually, do you even have to?
I don't think you have to.
Yeah. It's just kind of an option, right? It's a nice option to have.
It's nice to have.
Yeah.
Quartermaster, that's a good draw for next turn.
Yeah, it's going to give the Silverhand Recruits a second arm.
And a leg.
That's pretty awesome.
And hero power. That's quite a lot of damage next turn.
Yeah, Quartermaster is going to win the game. It's kind of interesting when you look at the way Paladin used to work, where this hero power was mostly only relevant against Priest and a Warrior, and now it works against everything.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, you don't have those... And Choke just fireballing his own face, doing the honorable Sudoku. Very, very nicely done by Shogi.
Oh, Strifeco with a smile. Adorable.
I don't think this guy's got a bad bone in his body. Like, I've never seen him... I've seen him run into the worst possible RNG. He's just like, oh. That's it. Oh. He's like, okay. I guess. And he just like moves on, no problem at all.
Kind of similar to Life Coach.
Yeah, they just laugh it off. I've seen Life Coach get mad, not mad, but like really angry once. What happened? I don't even remember, but... I was really surprised. It was the first time I'd seen him like a bit on tilt in front of a situation.
Okay.
But it never happened again, so I guess it was a one-off thing. So that being said, Strifeco getting the win with his Paladin, locking the game. He's got Warrior, Warlock, and Hunter left against the entire lineup of Sho. Warrior's going to be playing next up against Sho's Mage again, who's going to be trying with Mech. And I think this gives a bit of an edge to
Strifeco.
Yeah, Strifeco's got an edge with this one.
Unless he whiffs on rolls with weapons. I mean, without weapons.
Yeah, if he doesn't get any weapons, if a good Snowchugger comes out and there's no execute or weapons to deal with it, then that could just be an instant blowout. But it's usually easier. And even if you do get blown out, if you stabilize somehow with like frauding, you trade here and there a cruel task for the minions, the moment you get one turn with a Grim Patron, you're good.
Yeah.
One turn with Grim Patron against Mech Mage, you're usually going to get carried by it.
Especially when there's an example of Cogmaster on board, and you have the way to kill other mechs, and then your patron can trade for the Cogmaster,
you have an Oil Trons, you've got Cogmasters, you got two attack mech warpers, you got like a lot of outs to just create new patrons, which makes the whole thing, you know, pretty interesting to look at. But again, no weapons, same thing as Zoo. You just get you're the little dwarf in the Moria.
When you think about Mech Mage, it's just the same deck as Zoo with different cards.
Yeah, and since Zoo came back, Mech Mage went out.
Yeah, because it's Zoo is just better at what it does.
Yeah, and interestingly enough, Mech Mage was the placeholder until Imp Gang Boss came up, and then Zoo said, well, you know what, now I guess I'm good, and Mech Mage got pushed out. Mech Mage was also very good against Druid, but Zoo is also as good. The difference is that Zoo is better against Mech Mage as well, so it does make it a bit better. So we're going to be moving on to the game very shortly. In the meantime, again, if you want to vote for your favorite faction, Alliance or Horde, hashtag KPL Alliance or hashtag KPL Horde, again, you know, the two players in the finals.
This is the Alliance battle again.
This is the Alliance battle. If either of those players got to the finals, we had a faction fight.
Yeah,
but now we're going to get like a faction kill at the top. But.
Yeah, that's true. Well, so we have two Alliance at top 4 and two Horde at top 2.
Yeah, that's... Sounds like
clearly Horde is better.
I think if this is not a good reflection of WoW PvP, because I can tell you right now, there's no one from the Horde at the top right now. No one.
Really?
Yeah. You don't understand how imbalanced it is. You have no clue. It's not
what
even
happened,
humans. That's what happened. But it's a long story.
They have like a passive?
Yeah, they have a racial ability that's just beyond broken.
What it does?
It's like a PvP tool that everybody else has to buy, but for them it's an item, and humans get it for free.
Okay.
Yeah, it's broken.
Okay, so I guess it's like...
So humans master race is all I'm saying. Which means alliance is better, except in Hearthstone, where that doesn't seem to hold true.
You know what I miss in Hearthstone? Mm. When we were playing World of Warcraft TCG, we had a clear fraction
For
diversity.
Each character, right? Yeah.
Like, you could have played alliance or horde. Then we also got demons, like a faction.
Yeah.
And also we had Scryer. And Aldor
as well.
As an addition to your main faction.
So you could get like subtypes of creatures within the faction.
But
themselves.
Still, your main difference between decks was a hero from Alliance, hero from Horde, or hero from Demons, and it was really cool because some people were playing on the Alliance, some people on the Horde.
Yeah.
And I kind of missed that in the Hearthstone.
Maybe one day we'll get something along those lines. I wouldn't be surprised it's on the radar of the devs at some point.
Not really, because you already have neutrals, like gnomes in a warlock character deck.
Yeah, but maybe different heroes that represent different factions.
Well, maybe, yeah.
Like,
maybe.
You get an undead priest. That would be my call. Or an Alliance warlock. Like, a gnome warlock would be pretty cool to play.
Yeah.
All right, so into the game here, we have the mid-range Zoo from Strifecrow versus the Mech Mage from Sho, I think. Wait, didn't Strife... Wasn't Strifecrow supposed to be a warrior?
I was... yeah, I guess so, but I think that was a mistake.
Mistake! Well, he doesn't play Draxxus. Or does he?
Maybe.
We saw Mal'Ganis, but I'm not sure about Draxxus.
Implosion. I still remember when people were saying, like, Mal'Ganis? Awful.
Yeah, unplayable card, and then suddenly everybody played it.
Yeah.
It was...
I have seen the same reaction about Voidcaller. I was like, wow,
this
card is broken.
Whoa, this card is crazy.
Yeah, I said it like with next expansions, this will snowball out of control.
Yeah.
And people are like,
Did you have no good demons? Yeah, just you wait.
Yeah.
Just you wait.
Just wait for next expansions.
Oh man, Sho is not liking this board at all. That Nerubian is not nice.
So you go for the trade? I guess it's awful.
I don't think you can afford it. You have to punch face and let him make it.
Zoo has so many drops that he can just, you know, throw into the mirror entity without any kind of...
Drawback, yeah. And now the Voidcaller is being even more annoying.
You have two Doomguards now.
Yeah. And none of them is going to trigger a mirror entity if it does get popped.
Yeah, that's also true. Very important.
Which gives the Warlock player a lot of, attack and health to deal with, or to manage with, without having to play into anything unless he top decks something he's happy to throw away.
So I guess you attack with the Voidcaller to the Chugga-Chugga.
Or do you just implode it? What do you prefer?
I guess I would play...
I would implode, I think. Or do you not take the risk? It's just a matter of whether or not you want to use your Voidcaller
next turn
again.
You can do it like this. You implosion the Mad Scientist, you play Abusive Sergeant, kill the mech. And give him the Abusive Sergeant.
Oh, to kill your Voidcaller and get a demon out.
Yeah.
So you buff the enemy's mech to get a Doomguard. You know what? That would have been a great play.
Right.
I think that would have actually been a great play because he would have given his opponent an Abusive, which is a nothing.
Yeah.
And he would have also gotten a Doomguard out. You know what?
And you have Doomguard with 5 attack immediately.
Yeah. No, I really do like that that line of play. Maybe he wasn't really interested in trading the minion.
Well, now he gets the trade for the Pilot Shredder, and he will get it out eventually out too.
What he's getting effectively is a better trade.
Yeah.
Like, he's getting more value out of it that he might not want to throw away last turn. Oh, wow.
Yeah, well, that will eat a 2 imps.
Yeah. Or 1.
Why one?
With the direwolf.
Yeah, right, there's a direwolf. Never mind.
Not a lot of food for Milhouse here. Just the 1 imp. What a sad day for
And you play the Haunted Creepers on the left, right?
Yep, I think so. Makes a lot of sense.
Yep.
And Sho is so far behind right now.
I think there's no way.
Well, never mind. We kind of lied.
Now he has a.
The thing is, he gets the second Doctor Boom, which is a big deal. Like, it's really a big deal when the opponent gets the initiative on it.
That's true.
So the fact that Strifecrow can play as Dr. Boom here, no thinking involved, is really
and
difficult.
And he trades for the whole board.
Yeah,
and
doesn't
he will
even
still
lose.
Keep his Doomguard on board if Stro wants to play his own Dr. Boom in this game, basically, right? Because that's 7, 15, 15, 17, 18, 19.
Doomguard,
most likely GG.
Wow, this deck for Stro has not worked against Strifecrow yet.
I feel like Mechmage is really weak in current meta game.
I think Mechmage is not good right now. As I said earlier, it's gone.
Uh-huh.
It's not completely gone, but what I see of it doesn't impress me. I feel like you might as well just play the Warrior.
Or the Temple Mage.
Temple Mage is better even at the moment. Even though it's not amazing because it can be countered easily if you're playing the wrong secrets. Yeah, I do like Tempo.
Why are you saying wrong secrets and you're looking at me? I love Spellbender.
You love Spellbender and Counterspell, but that's great. I mean, I love those cards. I just play them all the time. They just don't always work the way I'd like them to in the aggro decks.
So I guess you go face with everything?
I mean, it looks like an SM Org board to me. But
7, 9, 10, 12, 14, 20 damage. You can go for maybe a lethal with double bombs to the face for 7.
If that works. Oh. Well, maybe this will change things a bit. Let's see.
Bam.
Well, that's your first step.
Yeah.
Oh my god, if this works.
No!
No! Oh, actually, yes.
Why?
No, not yes.
He just throw 2 damage off.
It was obviously much better to go for that, one chance.
Yeah, that was flashing.
At this point, you can probably afford doing it. I feel like some Hearthstone games come down to who can BM the best. And now I don't think there's anything that can bring Stro back besides Flamestrike. And even that's nothing.
Flamestrike deals like 4 damage to the Dr. Boom and gets out a Doomguard.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a great deal, bro. You get a discount on Doomguard.
Yeah,
opponent.
No discard and just play the minion. So Warlock is going to win here from Strifecrow over Stro's Mage. Mage is just not working for Stro right now.
Yeah, it's not working at all. So I guess now it will be met with Warrior.
Which is interesting because earlier the way Stro won against Life Coach's Warrior was a big misplay on Life Coach's part. So I'm starting to wonder if the game had been played out, would this mage have also been a weak spot for Stro?
I think it would have been a weak spot because it's weak also to Handlock.
Right.
It's weak to Face Hunter, I guess, kinda.
Yeah, I guess it does have. It doesn't have like a super lopsided matchup.
Yeah,
it can be like it's
well,
a
maybe
55-45 either way,
yeah.
Maybe depending on how the decks are built. But yeah.
Yeah, so, and Stro is sticking to the mage.
I mean, he has to win with it eventually in Conquest format, so there's a good argument to be made for it, and Strifecrow is going to go for his Hunter deck, so we'll see if that Hunter is also going to be able to deal with the mage.
I think we didn't see Strifecrow's Face Hunter yet.
We didn't see any Hunter from him, but I don't know if he plays a lot of Face Hunter.
I have no idea.
Yeah, I don't pin him as a player who does play that, but if it's the best meta call, then there's no reason not to.
Yep.
I mean, these players just play whatever's best a lot of the time.
Yeah, Strifecrow is known for playing also constructive deck. I would say he's good at tinkering new decks.
Yeah, taking a deck, modifying it to where it fits what he wants it to do.
He's a creator of decks too. Like when you think about the Grinder Mage.
Grinder Mage is his best creation, but sadly, it doesn't. It's always like short of being highly competitive. It's always so close to getting it done, and it's still one of his favorite decks. Despite the fact that it's a little inconsistent at times.
True.
All right, so Strifecrow's hand.
It is a mid-range hunter.
With Belchers, I think that, that sells it. Even, a lot of mid-range don't even run Belchers
with Freezing Trap, I would say.
Yeah.
I saw some people play Face Hunter with Freezing Trap. I strongly disagree with that.
Frezar and Kaldi, I believe.
Yeah, I think that's
Fnatic
awful.
Had a lot of those, if I recall. But I may just be mistaking the players. But I remember in KPL we had a few of those.
Yeah, it's really like counterproductive of what you can do with your deck.
It's like your game plan is not that,
yeah.
And you're going for it. Strifecrow's hand is gorgeous.
Do you like that? Coining out the Hunter Creeper in turn one?
I only like it because I have a juggler and I can handle any 2-drop.
I don't know, man. It's like
you're not
most of the situations I want to keep the
Web Spinner?
Coin for Handmaster on turn 3.
The thing is, Web Spinner is mandatory for Mirror Entity.
Oh, yeah.
That's the reason he kept it. Now he draws the second one, so it's meaningless. But I think it's like if you don't have that
Web
Spinner,
it's
going to be so problematic to handle it.
That's a very good point. I agree.
All right, Strifecrow putting down the creepers.
So he goes down with two mechs now.
Okay, those juggles, they don't be good.
You put out the nav juggler, then you kill the med scientist, right?
Yeah, and then you give him the web spinner. Might as well. I think that's definitely the order you have to do this in. Strifecrow's hand is pretty much the perfect hand to deal with a mech deck, like a mech mage as a mid-range hunter. Mm-hmm.
Because he has the second web spinner for turn 5 with Houndmaster.
With Houndmaster, exactly.
Yeah.
So I don't think it gets much better here.
He goes for the mech warper. So he wants to deny... Like, he wants to kill both mechs to deny the...
Blast mage,
but that's really risky. Like,
it doesn't guarantee... It's not guaranteed to work
at
all.
There's no way you can deal 6 damage.
No, I don't... I'm surprised that he made that play. But he doesn't want to give the secret out, and those knives are horrible. Worst knife juggler in North America.
He clearly doesn't know how to play the deck.
Clearly, Strifecrow has no idea what he's doing, right?
Yeah. No idea.
I mean, it's pretty obvious. That knife juggler is just missing all the targets.
Yep.
I mean, get good, mate.
But he doesn't kill the web spinner, which is really important.
Yeah. Because
now
the master is good.
No, you can't play the Houndmaster because there's Mirror Entity.
You have to play another web spinner with your juggler, I guess.
That kind of sucks.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I'm not juggling first here. After what the last one did to me, I'm not trusting it again.
Maybe you sacrifice first the web spinner?
To see if you can find... What beast would be amazing here?
Kodo for next turn.
Yeah. King of Beasts would be bad. It's always bad. Like, there's one game we saw where Sho got a King of Beasts.
Like, with 8 attack, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, that was a really impressive moment. It died, the BGH, but it was... it was an impressive moment. Oh!
That doesn't really do much.
Yeah. I saw an orange thing on the card. It's probably a good card. Oh, wait, it's Gazrilla. Oh man, whenever you see a legendary, you're super excited, then you think about what it is, and
it's like, oh, no,
you remember. He'll be dead by the time he gets it out.
Look at that, Corehound. Neat!
So useless. Oh man.
I saw that once in a competitive tournament, like in a deck.
A guy. Oh yes, I remember. There was the one guy with like a lot of basics in this deck,
yeah.
No?
Dreamhack Bucharest, the
first one. That was
one.
The one.
He was playing against Strifecrow.
Yes.
It was Gypsy.
I was like the hero of the day.
Yeah.
The guy
definitely won the hearts of the audience.
Definitely. And I think he tried to explain afterwards. He's like, I don't really know how to play the game. I just got the game and I'm enjoying it. And it was really fun to watch.
It is. And Strifecrow was like,
we need to play Bronze League Heroes. Like, we need the equivalent of Bronze League Heroes for Hearthstone.
Okay.
Like, which is, like, it was a series by Husky StarCraft who had all the people in the worst league of StarCraft.
Yeah.
And they just have recordings of the games, and he commentates them.
Really?
And it's, like, is the most awesome thing to look at. We need to have that for Hearthstone, I think. That would just be the best. All right, back to the game, though.
So I guess now you use Houndmaster.
There's another Mirror Entity, though.
Oh, yeah, really?
Yeah, it doesn't get better. It doesn't get better anytime.
Okay, now this sucks.
Although, does it suck, really, if you Houndmaster? I think it's still fine, because you trade with the Noatron, and then he has to trade into it, and you have Unleash.
Secret!
Not so secret.
Maybe it's not that bad, as you said.
Yeah, I don't think it's that terrible in this board.
Well, that Corehound will see some action.
Yeah, I don't know how much.
Well, maybe not.
Not after this.
Wait. Maybe
it's curving perfectly.
Maybe actually it will because
it's
have
a ghetto Dr. Boom.
Yeah, you have a turn 7 into turn 8 Yeti Best Mage.
Dude, this is just a crazy turn. Corehound is so sick. I mean, how do you even beat it?
Hunter's Mark.
Nobody plays that anymore.
I think they do. So I guess you play Hunt.
But like, you can't Hunter's Mark the face, so how does that work?
I have no idea. It's like too tough for me as a face Hunter player.
I tried, man. I really did try. I can't play Hunter decks.
Unleash the Hounds. You trade for the Azure Drake and the 4-1, and you go with two to the face, with one to the face, yeah, and play the Young Basilisk, right? That's the name?
The Young Dragonhawk.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sorry.
Young Basilisk. Insta-kill the opponent if you touch him.
No, it's with the side, you know? He kills with the side.
Yeah. So it's like an Emperor Cobra, but for face.
Yeah.
It's like a 5-man. It's a 5-mana 1/1. You can only you can only play it with Warsong Commander. But it's a Hunter card, so you can't use it at all.
Yeah. Oh, Tundra, look at that. Do you think he will play the Car Hunt?
I think it's so good.
Man. That's so sweet, bro. Damn.
Wow, big plays.
And I feel like in Harry Potter. So I guess you have to play Beltran now.
Oh my god. Yeah, you have no choice.
Great turn.
Yeah, this is just a sick turn for Strifecrow. And he can even play Gazrilla next turn. Like, this is looking good for Strifecrow.
What?
Like, Gazrilla comes down next turn.
Okay, you're trolling me, okay.
This is the best time of the day. When Lothar's casted for long enough that he's like, well,
it's what time is it?
Almost 2 a.m. Yeah, it's almost 2 a.m. here.
Yeah.
Local time, Poland. Sleepy cast, best cast.
I think that's the end of the game.
Not yet.
How do the...
He didn't even play Gazrilla. I would have played it to give false information to my opponent. So when he plays me next, he thinks I play Gazrilla.
Sure, bro.
No.
Everyone knows that Midran Hunter plays Gazrilla. And Pyromancers and Acolytes of Pain.
Yeah, with Hunter's Mark and Wild Pyro.
Yeah, of course.
Instant kill. Any minion.
Bang. And Tundra Rhino for the instant charge.
Of course. You have to play Culpet. Two Culpets. With Tundra Rhino, Gazrilla, Savannah Hymens, and King Crush. I mean...
No, you play Mage with Unstable Portals for Gazrilla and Tundra Rhino.
Sorry for what?
And then you ping.
Yeah, you just ping it and then you win the game.
Damn.
Rest in peace, mate. Yeah. So Hunter's gonna fall down to Mage. So at least that's one game that Sho's gonna be able to take. He still has to equalize 2-2 before he can go, you know, at least 4-2. But now the Mage is locked, so that's one good win for Sho. He doesn't have to go back to that. He's gonna be picking up his Hunter next against the Warrior from Strifecrow. And his face Hunter, which means Warrior is typically favored in that matchup.
Typically. Yeah. But the Grim Patron, I say, is less favored than Contra Warrior.
Yeah. It really depends, though, because the whirlwinds really make a huge difference, I find.
Double whirlwinds, yeah. They might make a difference, but when you play Face Hunter against Contra Warrior, it's like, oh, I guess I lose, right?
Yeah.
Most of the time.
You just, it feels like a not a loss.
Yeah, and when you play against Grim Patron, it's like, okay, I can win.
But frothing.
It's the one thing against Grim Patron, I feel it's not so lopsided as it is against Control Warrior. Yeah. So I guess the matchup is not that bad, at least in my eyes.
Yeah, I think you make a good point there, because Control Warrior is tailored around, like, especially with the advent of Shield Maiden that came out. Like, Shield Maiden with GVG really made that matchup a lot easier, where it used to be the case that Warriors had to run Unstable Ghoul to stop that kind of aggression. And now that's not the case anymore. Shield Maiden really allows them to, you know, free up that small curve and get decent beatdown in the mid-game.
But it's also important that Shield Maiden kind of allow you as a Warrior player to get more value out of Alexstrasza.
Right.
Because it adds armor, so you're getting lower for the Alexstrasza to have a bigger effect.
Yeah.
And then you play Shield Maiden and you're just like, yeah, whatever, dude.
Yeah, you solidify your health count even above what it should be normally. All right, we're getting to the game as I'm speaking, effectively. It's going to be a Face Hunter versus Warrior. I don't know. I mean, we saw the Life Coach play against Sho just a moment ago, playing the exact same matchup. And Sho made a really sick call a call that was really bad for him in that specific case when he kill commanded the Frothing.
Yeah, that's true. We'll see how it goes with this matchup. Like, maybe he changes mind about how to approach this matchup, like, go face.
Yeah, just punch face and let the warrior figure it out.
Be mana efficient about your damage.
Weave in as many hero powers as you can. Like, if the hero power is the clock.
This warrior has a limited amount of armor gain. And this is the key to victory as a face hunter. Because you know that he has... his only outs when it comes to armor gains are armor smiths.
Right.
So... if he doesn't get those armor smiths, it's basically the same as you play against a priest.
Yeah, because they don't have the... it will never go above 30.
Yeah.
That's it. And it's really interesting to look at the dynamic of that, because warrior is usually dominant because of the fact that they have two shield blocks, two shield maidens, and they're trying to set up the
and
perfect armor smith.
Yeah. Shield slams are insane. It's like... what's the warlock spell?
That deals damage to one minion?
Drain life.
Drain life, yeah.
It's the same.
Yeah, you drain, like, you armor up for two, you kill, like, an arcane golem. It's the same thing.
Yeah, you gain two, deal two.
Pay three mana.
Yeah. But, and it's more flexible than drain life, anyway.
Later, yeah, for bigger minions, it also works.
With shield block and shield maiden.
Exactly.
So it's like a better drain life. Look at that, no hands. Did you see that? The trick? That Strife Curse was?
No.
Like, he was hovering the card, right? And his both hands were on his head. He was like, look, mom, no hands.
You're creeping me out, Lothar. Magic Amy confirmed.
Misha is not bad. It's like...
it's not too bad, because it gets a guaranteed 4, but it could have gotten 8.
It's better than Leok.
Yeah, it is.
Two weapons, that's also not bad. You know that you'll have a steady amount of damage coming out.
The Grim Patron could come out next turn. Do you ever play it then or not? I kind of want to.
To play what?
The Grim Patron next turn. Or am I just mistaken? It just feels like such... oh, maybe Warsong with Ghoul. Nah.
Warsong Commander Ghoul into the 1-1.
Yeah.
And you keep the weapon.
And then you Warsong and you play Grim Patron and just go completely crazy.
Yeah, I think that's the play.
Yeah, the Ghoul really changed the line of play that I would have taken this turn. Instead of saturating the mana on the one Grim Patron, you're going to do it on two minions and you're going to get an even better board. Well, I mean...
I guess Grim Patron itself is not so bad.
It's pretty good, yeah, but I think the Ghoul really
changes.
But
it's too weak to Explosive Trap.
On its own? Unless you AoE it after, yeah. You'd have to trigger like a Whirlwind on its own first, get a fresh...
I guess that's the best way. So you kill the Ghoul now, and then you Explosive Trap? But it's so...
oh man, it's so terrible. If there's a Grim Patron lurking around... although they're not going to get charged. Only one of them will.
No. You attack... wait. How is the trigger then? You can trigger the Explosive Trap while you have the Grim Patron out and still a Warsong Commander alive.
Yeah, because you trigger it with the Ghoul. Unless the Hunter kills it off. So
you trigger it with the weapon.
Yeah.
Or do Ghoul, yeah, that doesn't...
but it does, it's going to attack, deal damage to the Warsong anyway. What's the big problem here? But wow, okay.
So in this situation...
well, good game. RIP. Rest in peace, show.
Why? Please elaborate.
Grim Patron?
It only spawns...
well, it's not lethal, it's just...
okay.
Stupid
you're
damage.
You're confusing me. So I guess...
Leok,
well, if you attack with the Grim Patron into the trap,
Ghoul triggers.
The Ghoul triggers, it kills the Warsong Commander, it probably gives the charge to the next minion.
Yeah.
So I guess. It's really weird. Like, this is the first time I see this interaction.
Situation?
So, yeah.
Well, you'll get the charge on if it triggers from Explosive Trap and the AoE from the Ghoul. You're supposed to get one charge on one of the Grim Patrons. But there's like five of them that are going to spawn out of your weapon and everything else.
Yeah,
he's
going to
go for
better.
The Emperor play. All right.
You have a zero mana execute, one mana battle rate. I think that's fine.
Yeah, for card draw replenishment, it definitely makes sense. And you can also counterpoint the hero power.
You want
the hunter
to draw the Frothing Berserker now, in this situation, to give it charge.
Yeah, just give it charge and forget about it.
Yeah.
I guess that makes a lot of sense. He's going to have to start weaving in his hero power soon.
I don't like the weapon now. He just used the weapon.
Yeah, I don't agree, but...
So it's better to use Arcane Golem, Phase, Lepronom, hero power.
Yeah, for mana saturation, and then you're guaranteed damage output. But he wants to get the extra charge, but I don't know about that.
I really dislike
it. I don't even know if he'll have time to get the extra charge played.
It's like, it doesn't really matter if you have two or three durability. There's no more than three turns to win. There's like two turns to get to the game to be decided. Right?
Yeah, no, I think you're right. No, I think you're right on this point.
Battle Definitely. Rage first, now. One mana, three cards, I think that's okay.
You don't wait for Grim Patron?
Well, does it make a difference? You have a four mana Grim Patron, right?
Yeah, you could draw like infinite cards anyway.
Arcalite of Pain doesn't do much. Whirlwind doesn't do much.
With Frothing, it would be nice, but not
yet. He wanted the Armor Smith or Frothing.
Mm-hmm. Just snowball the amount of damage income he's taking and make something of it. Because now it feels almost like a bit of a waste, but without being a waste.
The problem is the Unleash the Hounds might trigger a lot.
Yeah, but he's going to get... That's the big issue he's running into, is if all the Grim Patrons are on one... That could be a problem.
Get in here!
Now, usually, he should be giving charge to the other Grim Patron.
Well, let's see what happens. Yeah, it does have
both charge. Of them will have charge, usually. Did one of them disappear?
No, the other one died,
that's right.
It died. So I guess you don't use the weapon right now.
Well, is that game? Arcane Golem, 4, 5, 6, 7...
Arcane Golem hunted and unleashed the hounds.
Really close, but not quite.
4, 7, 10.
One off. And...
Do you die next turn? I don't think
he
so.
He might, depending on what Strifecrow top deck. So Frothing, no charge, wouldn't do it.
He needs the second Warzone Commander.
Yeah, now my question is, does Show trade? I don't think he does. He's thinking about trading. Just thinking about it.
Okay. Well, he has lethal next turn, most likely.
Yeah, no matter what. If he trades, it's the safer play.
Well, what if Strifecrow draws Armor Smith? Then he wins, basically.
Here, I think that would be something of a win, yeah.
Oh. There's an Enrage. No. So you have to drop Acolyte of Pain.
Yeah. And then a Whirlwind. No, Enrage first.
Enrage first.
Yeah. Does Acolyte... Yeah, I was going to ask, is Acolyte better than Gnomish?
I would say it is.
Yeah, because you get more cards.
Yes, now you have to drop the Acolyte anyway.
Yeah. Speak to me. Alright. Surprise, I thought you would play Whirlwind
first. I actually dislike the...
He's waiting for the perfect...
This is why I would do the Enrage first.
Yeah, no, I agree.
This is so much armor that you didn't get.
Well, he found what he wanted, at least. That's a happy pickup by Strifecrow. He's going to be able to kill off... Well, get himself a bit of armor, I guess. Over 9,000.
Yeah, but still, he would have, like, twice the amount if he would enrage first.
Yeah. This Whirlwind... This should be what seals the game, right?
I guess so.
If the game is won, it's going to be on the back of this. Because the Leoc dies...
It dies to a zero mana execute, yeah. And then he armor ups.
So even with...
Wait, why are you trading? To get one armor? Yeah, I guess that's...
No, you have to do it, just because if Unleash hits...
No, there's an execute for zero.
Oh, he could have played it, yeah.
Yeah, but he gets one armor from that, so I guess that's fine.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6...
And he wins anyway next turn.
9, 11... Actually, Kill Command would be lethal. I think. He would
three,
be close
six,
to
3, 6, 9...
Yeah.
14, 16, 11. Yeah, that's lethal.
If he had Kill Command, this would be game.
Interesting.
And as it is, I think he's going to be one
now
off.
He is one off lethal.
That last trade. Instead of execute.
Yeah.
that last trade instead of executing. Yeah. Wow. What? What? Strikecrow, you're a sick human.
That was crucial.
Yeah, I don't even understand.
This trade just won him the game. But on the other hand, the inner rage might have cost him,
yeah, if it didn't work out, I guess. Strifecrow is a sick player. Mm-hmm. And Sho's going to have to try. But then how much armor do you give? As much as you took away?
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah, you're just giving him more Grim Patrons and armor.
There's no way you can win this game anymore.
Yeah, even if everyone gets in here, it's pretty much over.
Well, you can kill the armor smith and just go face with everything.
That is the only way you're going to be able to have that damage stick around.
Otherwise, you just instantly lose.
Yeah. He's going to have to trade into one of the Grim Patrons and just punch face. Did all the hounds go through?
I'm not sure. There are two from the left that didn't attack, right?
Alright, there they go. Oh, one of them didn't.
I'm not sure. It's too late.
Yeah, I think I missed out on what happened there. Now Grom.
Grom and coming out. What?
Oh, I don't think he's got a way to enrage it.
Four, but six, he's just nine, lethal 12, with the weapon. 13.
Yeah, weapon is...
Yeah,
is
without lethal. Weapon even.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's 3-1 for Strifecrow.
That's almost a match for him. So his Grim Patron Warrior winning against Hunter is no real surprise. I mean, I'm not really surprised by the outcome.
Mm-hmm,
he's got a Hunter deck of his own left that he lost with against the Mage from Sho.
Yes,
so that's the last deck he has to win with. And Hunter, as we've seen, is fairly weak against Grim Patron, which Sho still has, but it may be better if it's mid-range. Because the mid-range Hunter from Strifecrow may be better than Face Hunter.
But I would actually prefer a Face Hunter against...
Grim Patron?
Grim Patron, yeah. I feel it's like the mid-range Hunter is too slow.
To actually put pressure on. Okay, so Savannah Hymen may be good against Control, but maybe not as good against
against Grim Patron. Because even that would be like executing Grim Patron on Savannah, right?
Yeah.
Then you're putting 2/2s on board. And those can
those two can trade with Grim Patrons and just spawn even more damage. This is actually a really interesting dynamic because the fact that Face Hunter is better against Grim Patron, yet not amazing, but it's still better than mid range. Like the Grim Patron deck for Warrior really flips upside down all I know about matchups, in a way, because it feels like the weaknesses of Control Warrior aren't the same for Grim Patron and the other way around.
I feel like the mid range Hunter against Grim Patron wins if he gets a sick Huntmaster. And double Belchers.
So if he gets like a really good Haunted Creeper with Houndmaster...
Yeah, Haunted Creeper is the best, actually. Yeah, it's the best target for the Houndmaster in this matchup, I would say.
Interesting. I'd have to actually look into it, because this is one of the matchups. Midrange Hunter and Grim Patron don't seem to be in the same meta. Like, I haven't seen much midrange Hunter since for a while now. It's coming back more so than Face. But I'd have to say it's not one of the top decks that I've experienced at the moment. So maybe.
Yeah. Totally agree about that.
I have to watch tournaments to keep up.
There's a lot of them.
Yeah. Grim Patron is everywhere as well, so you can't really miss it. Like, initially I was afraid that we wouldn't see much of it. Now I'm like, where is anybody ever going to stop playing the deck?
You're like, you open the closet, Grim Patron. You open your toilet, Grim Patron is actually, sitting there.
Yeah. It's just a surprise. Everything you do is a Grim Patron coming out. This would be a good ad for TV. This is a perfect Hearthstone TV ad.
Production, do you hear that?
Yeah.
You have to make that the ad.
Yeah.
Grim Patron everywhere.
Yeah, you just everywhere you go, try to open your cereal box, there's a Grim Patron coming out.
<It's> like, with the cheers playing out. It's like,
Everyone, get in here. That would just be the craziest ad.
And then you take a spoonful of the cheers, and there's like a Grim Patron in it.
In the middle, there's no way you can get away from it.
You're in the store, you want to pay for your stuff, and you like open the wallet. There's Grim Patron in it.
Yeah, I mean this has to be the best one. Now the next match is gonna be Hunter versus Hunter. Sho's gonna go for Face, and I think, as we said earlier, this is the best. Face Hunter versus mid range, almost always a steamroll for the Face Hunter. So Sho should be able to take this one.
By the way, exclamation mark,
PAX. To get packs. Yeah, we're giving away packs on the stream. So type in !! PAX, you'll get a chance to get some of the possible 500 500 that are being given away, and I think more may be added if the 500 are all exhausted.
I guess they're all exhausted already. Like, probably, why wouldn't be? Yeah. Right?
Why wouldn't they be?
Yeah.
I'm sure there's more than 500 of you in the chat, and if there's not, then raise your kappas.
Kappa kappa, there's a leper gnome turn one.
All right, so Sho does get the leper gnome start. That's
but there's a hunted creeper to contestate it.
Yeah.
So it's not so bad.
Now, so far, I'd say like if Sho were on the coin with a double leper gnome, then it's almost unwinnable sometimes.
It doesn't look bad.
Ah, that abusive though.
The abusive, like it kind of acts like the same as the Hero second leper gnome.
Yeah. It'll deal two and then another
but
two.
But there's a Handmaster.
So Strife Crow does have a pretty good hand. The double creeper
snake
against
trap. Wait, Sho was playing double snake trap, right? Instead of freezing traps.
No, that was, what's his name?
Hyped?
Hyped was playing that earlier.
You sure of that?
Yeah. Oh man, that snake trap is actually going to be a huge issue. Because now the leper gnome can't be popped. It might turn into.
It's really funny when you say it can be popped because you know he's a leper, so it kind of pops.
That is
out.
Disgusting, Lothar. Oh man, you can't pop the leper gnome. Let him feel icky.
I guess yeah, weapon. It's kind of powerful here.
Actually, it's broken in this position.
Next gen explosive trap hero power. GG. Yeah.
Perfect curve. I think this is going to snowball out of control. Strife Crow is going to have to play for the Houndmasters.
Oh, there's the Misha. That's really important. But wait, there's an explosive trap.
Strife Crow knows too much.
Strife Crow has to play Houndmaster next turn of one on one of those hunted creepers.
So it doesn't pop, yeah.
Does he? Wait. Get in there, fight, maggot. Well, you play the explosive trap, right?
Or Arcane Golem Face.
I don't like this at all.
How does he trade with this?
Well, yeah, okay, that's a good point. Yeah.
Like, how does he deal with this without using Unleash and getting a lucky...
I guess it's a Handmaster turn. Let him handle that.
Hindsight, and mate, hindsight.
Then it's a Tap of the Owl. It's like, hoot, hoot.
So, Snake Trap. If you trigger Snake Trap because you have Unleash, I guess it's okay. Like, even if you attack Arcane and it's a Snake Trap, you just go Unleash and you wipe the board completely.
Maybe you wait for the Knife Juggler? No, it kind of sucks.
Yeah,
then you give out your opponent the ability to do the same.
Yeah. How do you feel about just Houndmaster Web Spinner? But he didn't... he played a bit too fast for me to ask the question. Might as well just...
I would like to see the Houndmaster Hunted Creeper more than
Web Spinner. The Web Spinner?
Yeah. Striker's still not out of the situation. It's like 17 to 25.
You would think that he's winning, but he's actually not.
Yeah.
And that's just because of the way Facehunter plays. Because they run no healing, having an edge of 10 health is
why am I a scientist?
Because hero power, I guess. He wants to curve in explosive trap.
No, you want to play for explosive trap now and hero power.
To get double explosive with Mad Scientist, maybe.
Yeah. And you get additional durability next turn. So you have faster damage.
Yeah.
And that scientist will be played anyway. So I strongly disagree with that. That's my favorite sentence this
disagree
season.
With that, yeah. Yeah.
Strongly. And now the Mad Scientist sucks.
Well, it's not that bad.
Yeah, it sucks.
Okay.
It sucks because you have 6 mana and...
But what if you, like, sacrifice it and you quick shot phase and your hero power? Like, you're gonna win in 2 turns, right?
So what about... No, you... in this situation, you have to do it like this.
Yeah.
Because you can't play the explosive trap.
If he did it the other way around, he would have gotten possibly another swing.
And a draw.
Mm-hmm.
And a draw from the quick shot.
Yeah, because he could have, like, puked his hand.
Now he would just, puke the hand, screw the hero power. Or just hero power and quick shot next turn for additional draw and possibly additional 4 damage.
And... Is it going to be a trade on the Houndmaster?
I guess so.
Nothing else makes any sense to me.
Yeah.
But why play the creeper?
I really...
Why play the creeper? Is there a reason to play the Creeper? You're just giving him incentive.
Well, you want to empty the hand because of Quickshot, I guess.
Okay, that's why. All right, you know what? That actually makes sense. Yeah, I was a bit confused, but it doesn't make sense at all.
Mad Scientist. Doesn't make a difference.
Yeah, Strifecrow could get lethal almost. He's got 4, 5, 8,
Well,
nine,
he has
10.
To trade for the Hunted Creeper. Not a possibility here.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
So I
he
guess
had lethal. Did he just missed it?
Wait, what? How? He has there's
Web
an explosive
Hero
trap.
Power Kill Command. Oh, yeah, explosive trap. Never mind me. I don't see the top of the board. I'm like, there's no question mark there. This is game. Oh, no, it's not.
Exclamation mark trap.
Damn it. If you want to win, a trap. See, the Sound Creeper did nothing.
Yeah, it emptied the hand.
Yeah, I get it.
I guess you play the Mad Scientist also. Might to deny the Arkham Golem, Leroy Jenkins, Wolf Riders thing.
Scumbag Wolf Rider.
Yeah,
I think you have to.
In the face.
This is, oddly enough, a close game.
It is.
Yeah, like if Show doesn't win now, Strifecrow could take it.
Well, he has 4, 9, 10 damage possibly. 12. Bow.
That's game.
Yep.
Bow quick shot.
He trades for the web smooth.
Of course. Thank you, Spectator Mode. This is the kind of thing that makes you go, wait, what? And then,
yeah,
oh,
like, okay, never mind.
Yeah. All right, well, that's going to be the game for Show, obviously winning his favorite matchup, Face Hunter versus Midrange. An expected outcome, I'd say, in this position. Now, again, Strifecrow still has to win with his Hunter deck. That's the last deck he has to win with. And I think Show's down. He's won with his Mage. He's won with his Hunter. He's down to his Warrior deck that we saw earlier and his Handlock.
True. So Hunter versus... Let's see what it is.
I think Handlock would be a good pick, yeah. I was going to say, Handlock is probably a decent pick out of the two. Grim Patron is solid, but if you have to go through Conquest, get your worst matchups out of the way.
Yep.
Like, since he has to go for a reverse sweep, which is interesting because Strifecrow went 2-0, and now Show managed to get a really good lead.
I guess Midrange Hunter is not a good choice in Conquest.
The what? Midrange Hunter? Yeah. I don't think it's... For Conquest, it doesn't feel as strong. On Ladder, it's amazing. I think on Ladder, that deck does really well.
So it should do well in Conquest too.
The thing is, the volume of games that you have on Ladder is very different. In Conquest, you have to go through 4 different decks.
And 4 different classes.
And 4 different classes, exactly, with the same. Whereas in metagame, sometimes on Ladder, you'll find sometimes that you have a pocket of very heavy, only specific deck. You build Midrange Hunter and you beat it. Mm-hmm. And then the metagame changes and you switch it out.
Yeah, well,
maybe on
that's
Conquest,
true.
You don't really have that opportunity.
Still, the Midrange Hunter can punish Handlock with Clear Commands. And
yep. They still can win against Handlock. Anti-Killbot made that a bit tougher because it's like 1 card, 8 health, as opposed to the Farseers and trying to scramble around with Siphon Souls. But it did... They can still get the win. It's just that if they don't get a good Freezing Trap, usually the Warlock can stay on the board and take the game.
Yeah. Well, but one Freezing Trap can make such a huge difference in this matchup.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Just a really one good Freezing Trap is enough very often to turn around. Like, there's a Drake trying to go in, you're out. The game
Everyone is out there.
Yeah. Everyone's out of here. All right, so we're going to see exactly how that works out. Midrange Warlock, Midrange Hunter versus Warlock.
Well,
I haven't seen enough of it recently. Like, it used to be everyone played only Midrange, and then Face came up.
Face never went off, like I would say.
I mean, it's always been around, but it got perfected to the point where everybody switched from Midrange to Face.
Maybe.
All right, so looking at the starting hand, Strifecrow does pick up the Freezing Trap.
But why do he need... There's no need for the Freezing Trap. He needs the Mad Scientist.
Yeah, he needs to keep the Mad Scientist.
So Mad Scientist and Companion Palette Shredder seems to be a good starting hand, I would say.
Yeah, I think the only thing that gets better is if you find... an Iron Beak Owl for the Drake, perhaps. Like, getting the Iron Beak Owl is a really big deal. Well, not for that player. That's not the right guy.
Oh, but look at that.
That's convenient in a Handlock matchup.
Yep.
I remember the days when that was my daily play, was Midrange Hunter versus Handlock. There was a time where that's all you saw ever.
Look at that. Show has third time the same opening. Ancient Water
with
into
Iron Beak Owl. Yeah.
Iron Beak Owl. Right. And I guess Hunter, that's actually sick. In my opinion. But this this is the same.
It's the exact same thing.
Exact same situation. Yeah. What do you want to do? And I guess you want to get the freezing trap out with the owl. That's insanely good.
Will it work, though?
Well, it will. Why it shouldn't? Like, there's already one freezing trap on board.
Now yeah, Juggler has no way to counter it. You have to just go for a Shredder play and hope that it works out.
But the owl...
The owl will just silence it off.
Yeah, and you trade with the Ancient Watcher. And that's like, okay, I guess I lose.
What comes out of this Shredder?
Nothing comes out.
If you played the Owl here, like, what does a Strifecrow do to counter it? Because he can't kill the 1-1. He has to play another Shredder into it. Which then Dark Bomb deals with that. So I think it comes down to what the second Shredder can really handle. Because the first one's gone, as far as we're concerned, I think. Unless he wants to Dark Bomb it and hope.
Yeah, Dark Bomb and Life Tap might be better.
Yeah. The card draw you get. But, it depends on what comes out. It's just that a lot of the 3-2s out there will punish you anyway.
Bam. The trade. Oh. Okay.
That didn't quite hit the face. I'm not too sure exactly. I guess he's trying to put pressure on his opponent, but now there's going to be a bow play, I guess. Now, you could play Freezing Trap on the Watcher, kill the owl, but I'd rather play the bow now.
Bow, kill the watcher, kill the owl?
Yeah.
It's kinda...
You're taking a bit too much damage, maybe, though. But yeah, it's not very mana efficient. So you just prefer playing the second Shredder?
What about if you just play Freezing Trap, kill the owl, and Hero Power?
Hero Power?
Okay. Or play... I would guess Hero Power.
The thing is, I think he wants the durability from the Eagle Horn Bow to translate.
Okay.
From the Freezing Trap. And that might be the reason why he's going for the mana inefficient play. For the durability efficient play.
The
basically.
Problem is Mortal Coil, but lucky for him, there's none. Belcher.
Yeah, on curve. The Emperor is not too bad. It's not like the biggest hand for handlock, but it's got very impactful cards. Like, if one mana Dark Bomb can really make a difference.
So, there's no way to deal efficiently with the... With the Belcher, unless you get Leok.
Yeah. Leok would be a really big deal.
This is a really rare sentence you hear. Leok would be great here. and Leok, like, gets out of the bed. He's like, what?
He called for me? Why does he have a dwarven voice? I don't know. Actually, it would also work with Huffer now. It would check the juggle.
Oh, yeah, right. If he hits the juggle. And he misses.
So you have the Hunter's Mark. No, don't do that. But this is really, really bad.
Oh, he has a trade. Yeah. This is awful.
Yeah, this is a terrible trade that he's had to make, and it doesn't even improve his board presence at all.
Hellfire.
Oh, wow.
Wait.
I think he just Dark Bomb Coil.
Yeah, Coil Dark Bomb is way better. Oh, yeah. Look at that. That's game.
Strifecrow could find a high main off the top.
Hellfire. I'm surprised by that, you know? Because you have the option to cycle through your deck.
Yeah, and he didn't. Maybe he's trying to be very aggressive and use Dark Bombs for the face, trying to get an early lethal. Mm.
Yeah, okay, maybe that will work too.
Mm-hmm.
I guess you're right. Yeah.
That's the only reason I can see why he'd do what he did.
Second Owl into
Hellfire number two, obviously, right? Like,
yeah,
at this point.
Yeah. At this point, you just don't care.
Just go all out.
So many possibilities.
What are the other options?
Dark Bomb again.
Taurus
with the owl.
Really? That's the one.
Okay,
I'm
confused.
Yeah,
now
I'm thinking about that, like, at all.
I'm legitimately confused.
Like, it was better than before, right?
I think so, but Show disagrees.
So Freezing Trap, and...
Ouch.
Do you have more traps?
I don't think
so. Oh, he went for my move against Life Coach. He killed the mad scientist and played the trap at the same time.
Yeah, just confusing the opponent.
Yeah.
It actually worked against...
Life Coach is... Sometimes he's easily confused.
Hey, what just happened? Where's the mana? Why
is...
Yeah.
But was passiert?
Strife Crow at a huge health deficit.
I guess that's...
And the owl just seals it. There's... It's like... Strife Crow doesn't have, I don't think, any whiplash mechanic here. There's the Defend of Argus.
Savannah Hymen seems to be okay. But then owl, the owl... Yeah. You have to kill the owl now.
Oh my god, with the unleash. Oh my goodness.
No, with the weapon.
No, because you can't let the healbot return.
Oh yeah, right.
So you have to just play... Oh god, this is so terrible for Strife Crow. He's one man off.
And then next turn is Dr. Boom, yeah. Seems like a good play.
Yeah, I mean, this is so difficult for Strife Crow. It's not impossible, really.
Awful.
It's almost as bad as it can get. Well, tough decisions.
I spaced out, sorry.
I just said tough decisions because this seems to me like there was no winning play no matter what you do in this position, but maybe I'm not looking at this right. This is probably the only possible winning play. If there even is one, right?
Probably. But then there is...
Wait, you go face with Owl, Dr. Boom, double coil, your bombs win.
Oh yeah.
That seems like a really convoluted play.
I guess you play the Owl, Silence, Hellfire, double Mortal Coil.
That's the safest play, yeah.
How can you lose?
Doesn't port board presence, but the enemy's on 5 health, so how do you lose with that?
Yeah, and then you play next turn Dr. Boom, and that's it.
Yeah.
Or you just play Dr. Boom now. And you silence, like, there's no way he can kill you at 20. So you play Dr. Boom.
And you just forget about it,
and
yeah.
And forget about it, because then he uses Hound Master.
When in doubt, Dr. Boom.
Yeah, it's like, okay, I guess I play the Hound Master to, you know, taunt up my Savannah,
but this backfire?
No, there's no chance.
With Hunter's Mark Unleash?
He's so low, and you have a Hellfire in your hand. And an owl. I guess there's no backfire here.
Famous last words.
Yeah, it's in memoriam. Damn!
Oh
fall
my
to the
goodness!
Face. Oh my damn! Everything
okay.
Went ham. Oh, okay, that's GG.
Hellfire is gonna take the game here.
Dr. Badan.
Always 5 damage to the face, getting a free kill command here as the Warlock player. No problem, just Hellfire the Hunter down.
Damn.
So Strife Crow does get equalized in the series, which forces a Warrior versus the mid-range Hunter. So that's going to be a bit tricky, I think.
I guess I would say Warrior is favored?
I still think it is, even in mid-range Hunter. Like, yeah. I think Face Hunter is a lot easier, but mid-range is still probably slightly favored. It's a matter of how good you can make your Grim Patrons.
It's way slower. Like this Face Hunter is, this mid-range Hunter is way slower, so you have more time to develop and like be safe.
Yeah.
Because you know there might be turns like Belcher. Okay. No, damage not dealt. Five mana for no damage.
I think Freezing Shroud is a big deal though in that matchup.
You think so? You just play
Warsong
Commander.
Doesn't matter, yeah.
Warsong Commander, whatever. Into explosive.
Warsong Commander, whatever.
Yeah, well,
into whatever. Like, yeah, what you actually need to win the game.
Imagine, like, this situation. There's a freezing trap.
Yeah.
You play Warsong Commander. You enrage your first patron, right?
Second one goes in, or
second
the first
one goes
yeah.
back, and then next one. You can even, like, you know, whirlwind afterwards. So you have 4 patrons.
Yeah,
one
with
goes
the Grim
back.
It's actually very easy.
And it's like.
I think Hymen is still a problem, but that's always the case with Warriors, so we'll
yeah,
have to
well,
see
yeah.
if... But as you said, the Hyenas, they're 2-2s. Yeah. That's an issue.
Even if there will be like a freezing trap for your Frothing Berserker, you can play Warsaw Commander into Armor Smith, an example.
Yeah.
Bones back the Armor Smith. That's only 5 mana to do this play. And your Frothing Berserker is still safe on board. And yeah, it might actually be threatening lethal, an example.
Well, whenever you have Frothing on the board, though, the Hunter has to go out of his way to take it out.
Yeah.
Like anyone has, actually, at this point. It's just kind of a weird dynamic the way Grim Patron works, because the metagame's not quite been mapped out. And mid-range Hunter is definitely the matchup I think I've seen the least against Grim Patron.
I guess.
By a long shot for me.
Yeah. I think I can say the same.
I've seen more, what was it called? There was a deck you were unfamiliar with that was played with against Grim Patron earlier. Was it Priest? I think you hadn't seen much of it, and it's basically an auto win for Grim. Or Freeze Mage versus Grim Patron as well. Mm-hmm, Freeze Mage has a tough time versus Grim Patron.
Yeah. Well, that's a good curve for Strikeflow. Web Spirit into Mad Scientist into Bow seems like an okay.
Yeah, for I think it doesn't get much better than this. And Sho is playing the Inner Rages. You know, we did see a lot of players not play that in
I love the Inner Rages. It's a really great card.
Yeah, I think it's too versatile and too strong not to play in this day.
Yeah. And I always say the same. If a card yields 0 in the upper left corner, it's really good.
Okay. So like Wisp is just the craziest
thing. We might come to a point
where it's broken
in the game when the Wisp will be broken.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure we'll get to that point. Yeah. Hobgoblin wasn't quite the whole story.
Yeah. It's Hobgoblin is not the engine you're looking for.
Yeah.
It's like something different. Something combo
oriented.
And Wisp will be the catalyst for
like,
that.
Think of an Edwin, but a crazy one. Like, draw a card for each card you play this turn or whatever.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Something similar to, like, Buzzard, let's say.
Yeah, I could imagine that. Yeah.
There's the Grim Patron and Frothing Berserk already in hand.
These are the pieces of the combo that Sho needs to win, and I think because he's got double Inner Rage, this could just be a straight-up near OTK. If it's set up properly.
I think he doesn't want to go OTK. But there's a
lot of pressure on Strifegrove.
So, what about this? You play now the Acolyte, right? And turn 5. Turn 5 you go Patron, Inner Rage, kill the Pelted Shredder. Oh, wait, never mind.
Yeah, I don't think you can afford waiting, because the Freezing Trap is going to deny a lot of the things you want to do.
Oh.
That's not an issue for Sho, but it might have been one.
Well, now the
Captain's Parrot is Captain's worse Parrot than it was. I can't even believe this is possible.
I think that's the worst creature in the game.
4 mana, 1/1 that does nothing.
It's an epic.
Epic! I don't think I've ever seen such a bad card. And it doesn't even matter remotely for the warrior player.
Yeah.
Now this is just a whole irrelevancy.
Second Acolyte, that doesn't help you at all.
Yeah. And look at the damage that Strifecrow's putting out.
Okay.
I'm starting to feel almost like maybe we were mistaken about this specific lineup.
Maybe. I'm not saying I was. I'm not. Like.
Yeah. No. I'm starting to think we both are, because I was favoring the warrior a bit, but I think it might suffer from the same weakness that. Mid-range
still,
house.
Look at the amount of armor coming out next turn.
Right, that, yeah, you're right. That could
be
make
a
big difference.
You play Armor Smith. No, wait, it's 1 mana short. Never mind.
Yeah, you're 1 mana short of doing this. This is not a good play.
So I guess you're kind of. I wanted to say the better word, but.
The what?
Never mind.
Over 800 damage?
Might be the case. I think you have to go to Acolyte, Armor Smith, kill the...
Hymen?
No.
You have to kill the Weblord and take the Hymen damage? I think you just have to go all in on Grim Patron and hope it works out.
Kinda. Yeah.
I don't think there's anything else you can do that's going to win
but
the game ever.
You wait with the attack, right? You want to get the Armor Smith next turn with Whirlwind.
But you need to get 6 patrons.
Oh yeah, right, never mind.
As bad as it might look.
So now, if Sho top decks Unleash the Hounds,
good game. Yeah. Actually, Kill Command might steal it right now. It's a good game with Kill Command.
Yeah, it's a game. Never mind. Yeah.
Doesn't mean
Unleash. I'm tired, man. It's what time is it?
I don't know what time it is. It's about like 2:30 a.m.
And Life Coach and Kalento has to play. It's still the grand finals.
Yeah, we're still waiting on Life Coach and Kalento after this match. Now, StrifePro is gonna take the match versus Cho. It was a very long match. I think this is the first one that goes to 4-3.
The first and three, the entire playoffs. 4-3 and all playoffs here.
Yeah, definitely.
Congratulations to StrifePro.
Yeah, third place in the tournament. Cho doesn't get
representation. He's so close to the podium.
It must be disappointing a little bit because, as you said, you know, an underdog wants to get himself a representation in a very high-profile tournament in the top three, at the very least, on the podium. But he falls really short of beating StrifePro. It was a really close series.
Close series. Congrats to Cho as well.
Yeah, for getting where he did.
In a 20-players, really high-profile league.
Yeah.
I guess that's a good result.
I'd venture to say that's probably something satisfying enough. Although, when you're playing the game, you always want to get to the top. So maybe he feels a little bumped out, but that's going to pass. Eventually, he'll realize it was still a really good run. Yep. That being said, if you want to vote for one of the
two Horde factions,
the problem is we have no more Alliance players to go through. The only players left are the Horde. So I would urge you, if only for, you know, your niceness as a human being, to vote for the unrepresented alliance. But if you feel like sticking with the already winning faction, you can vote for the Horde. By doing so, you can just go, you know, go to Twitter, hashtag KPL Alliance to be nice, or hashtag KPL Horde to be really just, you know, a bandwagoner. So pick your party. It's your prerogative. That's nicer
than the poison.
Right. So we're going to be taking a short 8-minute break, then we're going to be coming back with the grand finals of the playoff. In the entire league, in fact, Life Coach versus Kalento.
Last match of the whole league.
The two most high-profile games, I guess, the players in the world at the moment. They're like, people just look up to them as probably the best players in the scene. So
yeah,
we'll be right.